Hello and welcome to another DF Retro Play. I'm John Linneman, and this time we're playing some special games here on the Xbox. We're playing Blinx the Time Sweeper. If you were around during the Xbox era, you probably remember this game. But somebody who also remembers this game is joining me on the call. It's Marc Triforce Duddleson.
Hey, well, I wouldn't say I necessarily remember the game in the sense that I actually haven't played them before, but I do have them right here, and I've been looking forward to playing them, so I'll see what I think based on your gameplay here today.
That's right. I'm going to walk you through this thing because, you know what? I'm actually a big fan of Blinx the Time Sweeper. I think it's a fun, cool little game that always kind of got a bad rep, but I think it's worth playing. And as you can see from the title screen, it is only on Xbox.
I love that they have to put that on the title screen there.
So let's just get into this. This is an Xbox I have never played this game on before, so it's a fresh save. You might notice this menu runs at a nice smooth 60 frames per second, but it's deceptive because the game itself is not.
Now, this is a game that I was kind of surprised, as someone who hasn't played it but was aware of it back in the day, and as someone who kind of paid attention to it as a fan of 3D platformers, but I didn't have an Xbox at the time. I was surprised to eventually learn that this is a Japanese-developed game. I feel like most of those mascot platformers of that era were Western-developed. And I was not expecting this to be a Japanese developed game. This was developed by Artoon, who was made up of a lot of former Sega people. And,
That's right.
I mostly know them as the developers of a lot of those bad Yoshi sequels, like Yoshi Topsy Turvy, Yoshi's Universal Gravitation.
Yes. Yes. Power that's Regions. The one.
Yes, that's not too good from what I've played. Yoshi's Island DS is okay, but it just doesn't have the spark of creativity that, you know, Nintendo's Yoshi's Island had. And then after Artoon was gone, some members reformed into Arzest, which later made Yoshi's New Island on 3DS, which is also kind of terrible. Especially music-wise, much worse than Yoshi's Island DS. But, you know, they also had further history with Xbox, like they worked on Hironobu Sakaguchi's Blue Dragon.
And Blue Dragon.
Yeah. Yeah, last story, that was Wii, of course.
So, yeah, Artoon did a lot of stuff back then when they were first getting started. And, in fact, one of the guys on the team was Naoto Oshima, who was the designer of Sonic the Hedgehog. Showing his prowess, I guess, here in Blinx, if you want to say that. But, so, Blinx itself, though, seems to have been funded by Microsoft, and this was one of the first games that Artoon made. I think their actual first was Pinobi on the Game Boy Advance, which I think was a launch title. Do you remember that one?
I'm familiar with the name, but
you play as a little bee, literally, and it's a side-scrolling platform game, and it even got a weird PS1 version, from what I recall. But Game Boy Advance came first, and then this. This was considered kind of... This was an interesting time in the history of Microsoft as a game creator, because this was when they were still trying to figure out what works for them, right? Like, the original Xbox showed up, and they were trying everything. Like, the first year or two of Xbox was filled with just so many fun, wild ideas, you could say, you know? And... Some of them worked, but most of them probably didn't. You know, you think of, like, Bruce Lee, that Star Wars Obi-Wan game that they helped with, Azeric, Rise of Parathia, games like that, right? Blinx, however, I think is actually a success from a gameplay perspective. It maybe doesn't fit the Xbox audience, but it's awesome.
Yeah, well, let me read you a tiny snippet out of the IGN review from the time, because what you're saying kind of, I think, leans into that, where they said that, where was it here? I don't know if you agree, but the reviewer here on IGN said that this is the first significant use of the hard drive. I mean, would you agree with that?
No.
I didn't think you would.
I mean, if that's what they're doing, it is interesting. But I would say, I mean, all you have to do is look back at launch, like the original Halo, with the way it handles level loading and this all that. I think that needed a hard drive.
Now I'm seeing the camera jittering a bit. Is that because of like earthquakes or something?
Oh, you're seeing some. There was an earthquake, yeah, and this stuff kind of fell over. And maybe, can I show this here? I have to remember the controls. Okay, so I can bring that up. Yeah, so you can pause time.
I think this is, but, I mean, I assume this is using the hard drive to some extent to write information to temporarily, which I think is where the perception is that this, you know, really relied on the Xbox hardware comes from.
Yeah, and I'm unsure exactly if this could not have been done on other platforms. I'm not sure about that.
I mean, obviously there's a lot more memory in current systems, you know, even if you consider the Wii, because, you know, features like this are actually super common in like retro compilations and stuff. Like some people can't live without their,
rewind
and save state type features, right? But this is like actually designed as part of the gameplay here.
It sure is. And you know, another part of the gameplay, oh, I can't change it. So this is one of those early 2000s Japanese games. So what direction do you think the camera moves when you press left?
Oh yeah. So this is going to be tripod style where you push the handle left, it pans right, which I used to be a very firm advocate for because I, you know, as a videographer myself, I always thought, you know, up is down is up, left is right is left made perfect sense for camera controls. And I think that's where game developers were coming from at the time. But once it became clear that non-inverted was going to become the standard, I decided I had to get used to it. So now games of this generation can be a little hard to go back to in that regard.
Yeah, and that's definitely the case here.
Although I'm curious, because this game is backwards compatible on Series X and Xbox One. I wonder if, because I could be mistaken, but I feel like some games may invert the camera or re-invert or normalize or whatever the camera controls. It might,
yeah, they've definitely made changes. And actually, that's something. Oh, geez, what am I doing? I got to get back into this game. It's been a little bit. Basically, the button configurations are completely foreign compared to like what a modern game would do. So,
I can always crack open the manual if you need a little help.
You could look in there and see. It's explained. It's just your muscle memory not valid for this game. So, the thing about this, I would say, is that it does have a very cool visual design, right?
Yeah, there's very few vertical right angles and stuff like
that. Right. Like, as you can see, they went for this sort of, like, distorted cartoony look. Almost like a Twilight Town kind of Halloweenish vibe in this first stage anyway. Which is really cool. You know, Blinx himself is pretty detailed. And to show this properly as it was, that's why, and I'll go in that portal in a second. I decided that's why we're playing this, you know, on an original Xbox, right? Like, this is backwards compatible, but we're playing this on a real Xbox from the disc, running through the RetroTINK 5X Pro. Yeah, that's right, to get the context. And also, backwards compatibility for Xbox titles, I don't like the way they scale up 2D elements, you know?
Yeah.
Because it's just like, they do like a bilinear filter on them, and they just end up looking kind of upscaled and nasty.
Yeah,
it doesn't really match.
I enjoy the cohesion of the original presentation oftentimes.
Yeah, that's exactly what we got here. So, and by the way, for those watching, this, we're not only playing Blinx 1, I also get the sequel.
And I noticed, you know, Blinx 2 does have this like super cool looking pig man on the cover, and it looked like the pigs were the bad guys in that opening cutscene, I believe.
Yeah. So, because basically each round or stage consists of these, you know, multiple stages with the boss in the shop from this sort of static menu here. But it's, you know, I don't know. So, I definitely remember this being a big deal when it first hit because it was the first Xbox game of this type, right? Like, this kind of thing was, that's not to say there weren't other platforms, but have a platform exclusive mascot game. Mm-hmm. Still, it was just at the tail end of mattering. Like, it still mattered, I guess, because Sony was doing them with Jak and Daxter, Ratchet and Clank, and Sly Cooper, and Ape Escape. Jeez.
Yeah.
That's great, actually. it's a shame that stuff went away. And Microsoft obviously wanted to try their hand at it, too. I mean, Halo was the big hit, right?
Yeah. Well, but, I mean, and there was even, you know, if I go back to this this IGN review, you're right that there was this perception that like you needed a mascot, because it says, you know, granted, Blinx is a cute and well-designed character, if almost completely silent. And he is more than a potential mascot for Xbox, though somehow I think Master Chief will remain synonymous with the box more than Blinx ever will. Some of the rhyme here is a little weird, a little awkward, but he says he is the future of Xbox games. I mean, it was perceived that like this was like a rite of passage for a console maker. I mean, Microsoft was new to this. We had seen lots of companies attempt and fail to break into the console market in the 90s, and Sony was the only newcomer to walk away from that successful. So it was still unknown if Microsoft would have staying power here. And
that's right.
You know, you got to have your mascot, you know? So
you do. But, and that's the thing, when they made this game, clearly there was the question asked, how can we do a mascot game but take advantage of the Xbox hardware?
Yeah.
And I think this whole time mechanic, which have you kind of seen how it works so far? I mean, we haven't done too much yet, but
basically
you collect power-ups that allow you to manipulate time, right?
Yeah, it's like so look, you got to rewind there. You got
I got to rewind.
I like exactly. I like how we're quantifying rewinds and stops is things you can accrue in a quantity.
Exactly. And well, you certainly can in Blinx, and it so let's demonstrate this here. So when I walked into this scene, as you saw, the ruins here crumbled, right?
You're right.
Which I can't climb them now. It's stuck. So this is obviously a point where you would use a rewind. So you hold the B button, use the D-pad to choose one of the options, let go, and bam.
So is that relative to only your localized area or a specific target or the whole level or what?
So it does seem to be... Actually, that's a good question. Can I not get this guy? Oh, dang it.
I mean, it's crumbled again. What if you run out of rewinds?
So that's... What was I doing? Let me try this here. Oh, I ran out of rewind, so we get to find that out now. So obviously, the goal of these stages... Well, actually, I opened this door already, so... The goal of these stages is to eliminate all of the enemies in an area.
Oh, okay.
So the maps, and that means that there's not that many enemies to deal with. And more importantly, the stages themselves are all relatively brief, which makes it quite replayable, I find. You know what I mean? Where it's they're fun to jump into and try to time attack.
that reminds me of, I another thing I brought up here was this, this user review of Blinx the Time Sweeper from GameFAQs from back in the day from 2002. Okay. And you know, they go through and rank, you know, rate all, you know, you have to do like we did reviews back then, you know, you have to rate the graphics and the sound and the control and the gameplay and the replay value. That was always so big, which they ranked it 10 out of 10 because the game is made to replay. So if you don't like replaying levels, then this game is not for you.
Oh, geez. Okay.
This review is from Howard 77 on GameFAQs. And this review has been a source of joy and strength to me through the years.
I love looking at old reviews from this era, especially when the user ones like this.
Yes, this one says, the title of this one, if anyone wants to read the thing in full, is I bought, with hesitation, Blinx the Time Sweeper. The rest is history. Which I absolutely love.
Speaking of history, you notice how when you finish a level, it actually shows your history with that level by showing a replay.
Ah, okay.
So it basically shows the entire playthrough of that level from cinematic perspective. And then, of course, I can continue a start, but that's a neat feature. And there hasn't, as far as I can tell, there hasn't been a lot of like technical information out there on how this game works. Like, I'm curious to know the way that they're able to spool data back in the way, however they're saving all this to make it work.
I mean, it seems to me that the core technical conceit of the game has more to do with the time mechanic versus the vacuuming / sweeping mechanic, because when you're walking up to these enemies and you're using your vacuum on them, it sort of looks like sort of almost a pre-canned like distortion suck in and then like almost fade out kind of effect. It's not like your Luigi's Mansion where you've got these like kind of complex physics going on with the vacuuming.
By the way, do you see this, the way this order system works? Essentially, like, I placed an order for things and I can't afford them all.
Oh.
Right?
You know what this menu...
And if I try to pay, it doesn't work.
This shop menu makes me think of Gunnack on NES. And
well, that's a random pull out of nowhere. I love it.
Yeah, there's like shops in that. And also makes me think of Forgotten Worlds. Like, I don't know, something about just like the way that the clerk was framed up in the scene with the menu and everything. I don't know. Just made me think of that.
So, continuing onward, I will say there, technically, I like what they're doing with this game. My big complaint back in the day and still today is the fact that it's only 30 frames per second, which I found to be kind of a disappointing thing, because all of PS2's big platform games, every one of them, 60 frames per second.
Yeah, right? And like you say, it's pretty small contained level, scale. So you would think that it could have been possible.
So it makes me wonder what they're doing that has caused this to be the case.
I mean, it could be all of the extra geometry required to create this sort of distorted style.
Possibly. But, I mean, it's not dissimilar to the type of geometry we saw in some of those PS2 games, sure, right? It's just this... Well, how it takes advantage of Xbox is by doing more complex shading and texture work, right? Mm-hmm. It's higher res. There's more effects going on, taking advantage of the system's prowess, capabilities.
It's a little hard for me to tell over Discord here, but is Blinx... Does he have any fur shading going on?
Let's get in close so maybe you can see. He does.
I mean, that was always such a cool signature technique generation.
It looks like the traditional shell texture trick.
Right, where it just like kind of extrudes it multiple times.
Right.
That
was a big deal on Xbox. They used that in a lot of games, including the port of Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 2X. All the grass was done using the shell texture trick. So it looked like it had real grass blades.
And funny enough, I feel like today it's more like Nintendo doing that kind of stuff, even though they're dealing with less capable hardware.
Well,
I feel like, I mean, it is kind of cartoony and not necessarily realistic, but it's an old school kind of technique that I kind of love. Oh, game over.
Oh yeah, the game is brutal with hearts, I guess. It's if you lose them in a stage, because I only got hit that once. I think they don't refill between stages.
Do you have a limited number of lives or just health?
I can only take one hit, it seems.
Oh, wonder if
I think you gather heart power-ups. Yeah, that was in the shop. So, and I am missing that. So, yeah, gotta be extra careful here.
You know,
another thing that's really nice about this game, though, is the music.
Okay.
That also has what I feel is a very nice Nights into Dreams vibe to it. It feels very Sega somehow, which is an awesome thing.
You know,
and look at that, you got blowing flags.
And I assume you can't interact with those, though, even though they sort of have sort of a wavy sort of thing.
You know, you'd think they would want to go after Luigi's Mansion, yeah, but apparently not.
There just doesn't seem to be like a lot of hard physics going along with the vacuum. No. You know, again, it's a little hard for me to tell what's going on exactly over Discord here, but when I see you vacuum up these objects, it almost looks like, is it taking like a snapshot of it and turning it into like a 2D object and then distorting it? You know what I mean? It almost, it doesn't look like a 3D object distorting like when it goes into your vacuum.
No, I let's take a closer look at that once I get back it out there. There we go. I got some hearts from the shop. And let's go in. Continue here. Wow, it's been years since I've played this, but this kind of makes me want to keep playing. Because it feels pretty good to control, I'd say. Actually.
After you get used to it.
Yeah. Like, it is a slower paced game, but there's something about it that just feels nice. Also, Blinx has a pretty nice looking projected shadow there.
Oh yeah.
But only one light source at a time. Like, you notice here, we have it from these light sources. But then when I run up here, its position changes. And now, whatever light source, I guess that one right there, is the shadow casting light source.
I mean, it looks
pretty
good, really.
So, what was it about this time period, though, in vacuums? Like, it's just odd that two main mascot-driven titles
from
the two platform holders have this mechanic of sucking things up with a vacuum.
So what do you think's going on with the distortion when they... I mean, I don't know. I could just be
having a hard time seeing
over Discord. But, no, it looks like as you turn the camera, it does look like... Well...
No, they're 3D objects.
Yeah, they're 3D objects. But, like, I could see that being, like, a sort of, like, performance-saving trick that some game would do. Is like, oh, we, like, snapshot it into a 2D object and then just distort from there. I don't know.
Oh, for sure.
But not here. Yeah, I can see it now that you're turning the camera while you do it.
Okay. By the way, I think we're going to do a little bonus before we look at Blinx 2. I kind of wanted to check out on the main menu they had a demos option.
Oh, yeah, we don't even know what they are.
I forget. Yeah, exactly. By the way, did you notice I'm picking up those little power-ups and then they make combinations that potentially give you time items?
Interesting.
So if you... if you match them together, you'll get the respective item.
So that's kind of like maybe...
So see, I picked up a pink cross there, and I think if I get 3 or 4 more of those, it'll unlock a rewind.
So that sounds kind of like a Shatterhand on NES, where you get
like
3 different letter icons, and then it becomes a different object depending on what combination you picked up.
No, bad... Oh, the hearts were crystals.
So what's the point of sucking up just, like, random trash cans and benches and stuff? Is it just for fun, or...?
No, it's because that's how you attack enemies.
Ah. Oh, okay,
four
trash. I see, okay.
That's your... You can only hold up to 5, I think. See? So it's... And it shows the different icons there to the right. So each icon... It has a specific icon for each... piece of trash you pick up.
Okay.
So these are obviously bad crystal combo.
Bad crystal combo.
So you can only hold 5 pieces of garbage at a time.
I wonder if you can upgrade that later. Time sweep complete.
All right, go Blinx. Do you notice he has those those shiny reflective mapped shoes.
Oh.
So all the metals use that hyper-reflective, where they essentially use like a reflective texture and distort it to make it look like shiny metal.
Now,
it's a neat little trick.
You know, a lot of games this generation, I don't know about this generation, but certainly now it's common in sort of more cartoony platform type games.
Oh.
Where you do have like a light-based shadow like Blinx has here, but you also have like a circle shadow under the character to just help you with aiming.
Yeah.
I see I that this boss enemy does have a circle shadow under him, but when you jump, do you gain a circle shadow when you jump or no?
I can't really check right now. So I'm trying to survive this boss battle. How does this one work?
I don't think you really do get a circle shadow, but obviously they have it there for that enemy so that you can kind of judge where he's going to land. I believe this boss fight is on the back of the box. It is.
There we go. So I use a slow power. There we go, and then it's back to action. Don't. That didn't work. Bad crystal combo.
sounds like some sort of Blinx. Some sort of ordering machine at Crystal Burger.
So you see how the heart system works there, right? Like when you take a hit, it actually rewinds to the point just before you got hit.
Oh,
so it's not actually like a typical life meter.
Interesting. So it's almost like Blinx is a one hit and you're dead character, except he has the power of time to bring him back to before he got hit so many times.
Dang on it.
Wow. It's been a while since I've played this. That is slightly frustrating the way that plays out. And I need to refill hearts. But I don't have enough money now.
I guess you can always replay levels, but probably a bit much to do for right now.
It's interesting though, because it's not like it's too challenging, but it's the type of challenge. Oh, I still have those hearts. It's the sort of challenge where you can't just like put it on cruise control. You know what I mean? Like you actually do need to pay attention to what you're doing and try to execute, which is fun.
Right. I mean, this was kind of a time where I feel maybe games on the whole were maybe at their least challenging. Because I think games were,
they were
attempting to be more friendly, get away from some of the infamous difficulty of, you know, 8 and 16-bit eras. And then like stuff like Souls-likes and Roguelikes like kind of brought challenge back into favor, and so now, you know, over the years games have kind of become challenging again. But yeah, at this time I think there was definitely at least a perception that games were easier than ever.
Yeah, exactly.
But there's obviously some challenge even at this
time. I am reminded that I'm not a huge fan of the way the retry system works when you lose a heart, because it takes just enough time where it feels slightly annoying. But that's just a matter of you gotta get good.
Yeah, gotta get good.
Okay.
Oh, so you're able to throw objects to him during pause.
Yeah. So now I can pause it again. Let me pick up these big weights. Oh no, he's up in the sky. See, I made a mistake.
But at least you've got time to pick stuff up.
Let's see what happens here. Oh, it actually got him.
Nice.
So let's continue here. I'll go ahead and grab the stars.
Are these items respawning over the course of the fight to give you more opportunities
I think so. Oh, come on.
Almost got it.
Uh-oh. No! Wait, I did get a slow. Okay.
Slow's good. That'll work.
There we go.
Oh, nice.
We got him. Actually, yeah, that is pretty fun.
It's cool that, I mean, I'm sure maybe later in the game there might be bosses that resist some of those powers, but it is nice that you can use those core, like, status effects on bosses, you know?
I think that's the whole purpose, right?
Right.
The bosses are designed knowing that you have that. So, okay, let's take a peek at that next world then. Continue on.
Yeah, see if see where the style goes.
Rank C. New stage is unlocked.
I mean, it's in a lot of ways kind of nice seeing this as a relatively linear, like, level-based game, because that was...
Oh, for sure.
I felt like that was something that didn't really come back to platformers until later. Like, it was much more about, like, fewer levels, yeah, but very large open levels. And it's kind of cool. Oh, now we've got a water effect going on here.
I love this kind of water.
I mean, it's no Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance, but
no, it's not that good, but it's still pretty good.
It's pretty good.
But what's cool about the water here is that when you pause time and run through it, you make waves that then freeze in place.
Ooh, that's cool.
Which I thought was pretty darn neat.
I like the brighter look of this world.
Yeah.
Now, are they doing they aren't doing anything with, like, bump mapping on any of these textures? I mean, actually, these wall textures look really low resolution.
You know, they're lower resolution than I might have expected. Yeah, it does, weirdly enough, this does seem like a game that could have been done on the other platforms at the time. At least in certain aspects. I'd be curious to know exactly how they're putting the Xbox to use.
Yeah.
Because they always talked about the hard drive, but, like, what are they doing? Just, like, writing, like, the state of things to the drive constantly?
You know, I'd really like to look at it. But, yeah,
look, like, at the I.O. and understand what they're doing.
Yeah, but now that I can see so much more clearly with it being a brighter world, like, yeah, like, the tile texture that you're standing on isn't that bad, but most of the walls are, like, oof, not that good looking.
No. They could definitely stand to be a little better.
But I feel like the overall aesthetic of the game kind of still comes together.
Yeah, I agree. It still looks pretty nice, I would say. Grab that. So the thing we haven't really seen too much here is how these early stages don't push it. But later on, there's a lot more stuff with worlds, like, breaking apart. And then you need to pause time, essentially, to... Uh-oh. That frog.
That frog got big.
He ate my power up. There we go. Now let's check out the water. Look.
Oh, look at that. That's awesome.
I love that.
That's so cool.
And then it... Look at
Whoa! That's amazing,
and then it goes
actually.
Nuts when it goes. Isn't that cool?
Okay, I'll admit, Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance might have a little competition there. That's pretty awesome.
That's a cool trick, I thought. I love that. The water all sloshing back into place.
Yeah, that's amazing, actually. I've never seen anything quite like that. Like, it makes me think of, like, you know, you would see effects like that for, like, I don't know, like, digging through dirt or something like that.
Right.
And other games, but then you wouldn't have the opportunity to, like, actually see it reform. Like, that's
exactly
really cool.
Yeah, it is pretty much using the equivalent of, like, oh, there we go, check it out. So they gave me some rewinds for a reason, because that bridge just blew up. So let's take care of him.
I mean, there is a lot of criticism these days over,
there we go,
sort of shader effects making it very easy for just to create good enough looking water that doesn't then, but not to make technically interesting water. Like, it's good looking water, but it doesn't behave in an interesting way. Like, it, there was in this era, there was a lot of effort in games like Mario Sunshine and obviously this, and of course Baldur's Gate Dark Alliance. To make water, like, really interesting. Of course, in Dark Alliance, it wasn't interesting from a gameplay perspective necessarily, but gosh,
it sure was visually nice.
It looks amazing.
So yeah, I think you're right, because these days a lot of water isn't that interesting.
Yeah, like, you know, it's, what I mean? it's there to look like water, but it's not for you to interact with in a way that does anything interesting with the waves and the physics and stuff. And, you know, even going back to, like, Wave Race 64 on the N64, you would have a lot of games in these first two major 3D generations where they tried to make water behave in interesting ways and for your character to interact with it in interesting ways and for it to interact with you.
I agree, exactly. And that's just something we're not getting much these days. Usually you get as a big flat body of water that maybe uses some shaders to simulate like ripples, but then it has like screen space reflections on there, which, you know,
rarely looks that good.
It doesn't look great. So the water ends up looking pretty plain and kind of bad, you know, which is a real bummer. Let's take out one more stage here, and then we're gonna hop over to those demos.
We have no idea. And we'll
see what's in that menu. And then we can briefly pop in Blinx 2 Masters of Time and Space.
Masters of Time and Space, I love it.
So here we are again. We got that cool water down there. Let's I need to get away from this fella. Oh, I'm gonna do the pause power up again. I need to do it.
You need to do it.
I need to find a I need a weapon. Man, what an interesting game this is. Like, you seriously got to sit down and give this a shot.
I think part
of the problem is those first couple levels, they're tutorial heavy. They don't really, they're fine, but not like exciting. Right.
Right.
But once you start to get into it, it's like, this actually feels really good to play.
Yeah, I'm definitely intrigued by the power-up system and all of the slow and pause features that you have and stuff like that.
So I'm going to go start. Let's see here. I'll start over here. And let's pause this water.
Heck yeah. There it goes.
We're going to carve up a hole all through here.
I wonder how that's working. Like, it's...
And then here we go. It's coming back. Boom.
And you actually see it like sloshing like below like the concrete or whatever that is on that slope. Like, it's not just a flat layer with distortion on shading on top of it like you get.
No,
today.
Exactly.
Like, it physically is moving. It's so interesting.
It's that old school mesh based water where it's like it's actually a 3D mesh surface that can deform, and you don't see a lot of that these days.
Mm-mm. No, it's really cool.
And that's a shame. Oh yeah, so here we go. Obviously this bridge fell down, so rewind it. There it goes.
So it fell down, but what will it fall down immediately once rewind finishes?
Let's find out. I think it does actually.
Or did something cause it to fall? Like, did that enemy do something to make it fall?
It's not always clear. So it's still there.
No, look at those logs falling. That makes me think of Mario 2.
Oh yeah. So I open. Look at this. Look at these metal textures in here. It's just a.
it's
just a texture designed to represent the scenery, but it's you know.
It's pretty garish, but you know what? I'm okay with that.
Okay. Oh, I got a slow.
You got a slow.
A slow.
That reminds me of when I first played Final Fantasy VIII. I was so amused by, like, you got a water spell. And, you know, you would have, like, you would draw, like, one water, two waters, three waters.
Oh, yeah.
Like, I thought it was so funny to think of waters as quantity. And now, like, because that was before, like, bottled water was common. So, like, you didn't think of, like, hey, get me a water. But then, like, you know, okay, this is a water now, you know? Like that. But, like, back then, it was really weird for me to think of waters as something that could be quantified and counted.
Look what's going on here.
All
that stuff falling into the water is creating big splashes.
Wow.
It's all violent looking.
Okay, like I'm really coming around to the water in this game. Like, at first I was like, you know, it's good, but I don't know. But yeah, this looks great.
It's actually interactive.
Yeah.
Uh-oh.
The touch on that boat looked a little finicky.
So let me try something here. If I do... this, what's gonna happen with the water?
Oh yeah, that's a good point. I guess it's not slowed down quite enough that you can totally,
so I can swim through it freely now.
Oh, look how when those barrels fell when you were in slow motion, they were falling like every several frames rather than actually falling in slow motion, updating every frame.
Yeah, that's really interesting.
I wonder if their positions are actually like keyframed.
Yeah, like fixed values.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, let's pause this so I can do that. Oh yeah, I need another one. Oh no.
Is that gonna hurt you? Okay, it didn't blow. I thought it was gonna blow up in your face as soon as.
Oh come on! I should have got him.
Those bomb explosions are not amazing.
No,
they're just like a single color doing like a Bomberman 64 kind of dome explosion. Except at least that had like some kind of like texture on it, I believe.
Okay, I gotta go back in the water.
Oh, there it goes. Oh, I wonder if you could like carve a path under the boats.
Oh, geez. The current is really strong.
Is the current partially created by the actions you made or just by the waterfall?
I think by the waterfall. Okay, so I obviously need a rewind to even get up there, but I got a bad crystal combo.
Uh-oh.
Alright, well,
anyway. Is this the end of Blinx's adventures?
For the moment, let's hop off back to that main menu, shall we? And quickly check out what the demos offer. Because I'd imagine if you purchased this game back in the day, that would be one of the things you would do. So,
absolutely,
let's pop back over there.
I mean, was that pretty common? I mean, as someone who didn't have the Xbox back in the day, like there were demo discs that came with like the Xbox magazine, right?
Yeah. Okay. So this is what we've got. Oh, what the heck? You remember this? Torque? I feel like this didn't come out. In a time of primitive custom, let's see what we got here.
At first I thought it was Tack, like Tack and the Power of Juju.
Which no, this is Torque.
Torque. What kind of game is this supposed to be? You don't think this came out?
I don't remember.
Here, let me look it up.
Let me look it up. I got it. It did come out.
Okay.
It came out in 2005.
Oh wow, this was in development for a long time then.
Yeah.
Did it live up to the adage of a delayed game is eventually good
Okay, I see what happened here. I forgot about this. So this was developed by a group, looking at Wikipedia, of course, the ultimate source of information. It says a former group of Rayman 2 developers, so people from Ubisoft.
Oh, were okay. On this. I can kind of see
and,
that.
And it was going to be a Microsoft Game Studios release, but when Ed Fries left, they gave it the boot, and then Ubisoft picked it up. And that's funny because that's exactly what happened with Psychonauts as well, if you remember.
Oh.
Psychonauts was also a Microsoft Game Studio, so which is ironic considering they acquired Double Fine eventually.
Yeah.
Right? But Microsoft gave it the boot. Like they chose to get rid of Psychonauts, and it was picked up by another publisher who published it. So this was a trailer, I guess, when it was still under Microsoft Game Studios.
And of course, as far as consoles go, Xbox version turned out far better anyway.
Oh yeah, the PS2 version of this game is horrible. It is not. You can tell it was not made for that system. Like, I don't think it's doing anything crazy visual wise, but clearly it was optimized and built around the Xbox, and like the PS2 version, it's not very good.
Yeah.
That was actually one of my, I remember when Psychonauts came to PS4 and I was like, oh, it's on PS4. And then I was disappointed to learn that, oh, it's actually just the backwards compatible version of the PS2 version. And you're like, well, that's no good.
Yeah, I'm still waiting on my physical copy of Psychonauts 2 from, I forget who did it. Was it IM8-Bit maybe?
Fangamer?
One of those.
I've seen those out in the wild. Are those not? Those are on store shelves here.
Well, at least if you ordered it through the website, I haven't gotten it yet. But that also has.
Look at this.
This is. Oh my gosh!
Wait. What Revel? Wait a minute. Did you see that?
Yeah. This is tacked Revel on to the was end not, of the.
Revel was not released for Xbox. Was it planned for it? No, yeah, it was definitely not on Xbox. Oh, there was a beta an Xbox version called Revolt Live. There was a beta version. That's what this was. I forgot about that.
Why is this playing at the end of the Psychonauts?
No. This is a separate trailer.
Oh, it's separate. Okay.
Yeah. This is just a trailer for Xbox Live.
Oh, okay. Gotcha.
And that's... Revolt. I knew that had not actually released on Xbox, but... Okay, so yeah, this is actually interesting, because this is footage of the canceled version of Revolt, which was only done in, like, a limited beta.
Oh, man, there's Roadhog in Cleveland, Ohio.
I love how he's got the headset on there. Like, dude, look, we're sitting here, we're playing a Dreamcast game, or like the PC game, on our Xbox online. He's like, bruh. Man, they definitely look early 2000s.
Yeah. I mean, man.
It's a shame that this game never got released on the Xbox, like, as a complete game, though, because I like this a lot. Have you played it?
No.
It's a racing game with RC cars, made by Acclaim, actually, for N64 as well. It's good on N64. And yeah, it's basically just a racing... It's like a kart game, but where you have, like, weapons and such, but you're driving little RC cars.
So this, obviously, would have been a lot more advanced than the Dreamcast and... 64 versions.
Yeah, precisely. Oh, well, they're showing off this voice masking.
Were there versions for GameCube or PS2?
No.
So there was no version this generation other than the online thing that you're talking about.
Correct. There was PC, PlayStation 1, N64, and then Dreamcast slightly later. And then I think they may have done like a Redux version or something.
Okay, well, here's finally gameplay. I mean, they weren't...
Yeah.
They were building all this up, I guess, just because the concept of playing with real people is so strange and foreign. Well, we have to...
Yeah, that's the thing. It's not about the game. It's about the Xbox Live.
Now right? what was the accessory they were pushing buttons on the top of the controller?
Oh, are you not familiar with the original Xbox Live?
I've never played original Xbox Live. No.
Oh man, you missed out. That's right, you missed out on Spies versus Mercs, which I was just raving about.
Yeah, you were.
So essentially, the way it worked is, remember how Xbox had those VMU slots in the top?
Yeah, it's got basically two dual slots. Yeah.
Right.
Like, well, Dreamcast.
Essentially, the way the headset system works is you put one of the... It has a little dongle that plugs into the top slot on your Xbox, and it has a headphone jack on it, basically, that you plug the actual headset into, right? And the button they pressed was the mute button. So it had a hardware mute button on the little connector there. So that's why all those headsets they're wearing, they're just plugged into that little thing at the top of the Xbox controller.
Interesting. Well, I mean, that's kind of the progenitor of modern DualShock and Xbox controllers that have the headset jacks right on the controller, which is super handy for even just headphone use, even not just chatting.
But the 3DO had that back in like 93 with a volume wheel on it, remember?
That's right.
That was the real deal.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Built you're right.
Into every
you're
right. And remember the 3DO, you could daisy chain the controllers.
That's right. Well, didn't you have to if you wanted to?
You had to.
Yeah.
But it also meant that you could do, I guess, more than two controllers easily, because you can just daisy chain them all together. Wow. This was not a planned part of this Blinx video, but
it's enjoyable.
This is fantastic to see this old promo for Xbox Live.
And like, the video quality is good on this disc here, you know?
Yeah.
For what it is.
Yeah, it's not the best, but it's actually pretty darn good, I'd say. There they go, playing some Revolt.
I'm just saying it's a good visual preservation of these ads versus what might be uploaded to YouTube from, way back.
Exactly. Wow, okay, that's Dark Master. As you can see, though, from what they showed of the game itself, it's pretty obvious that it was like N64 class.
Yeah.
Oh, look, they have one of those little 9-inch PVMs over there.
Oh yeah.
I have two of those. I love those things.
You know, I learned recently that the tube in that is actually rotated. Yeah. Like that's really that's why horizontal resolution sometimes looks shimmery when it scrolls by on those, because it's actually like using you know 480i worth of fields versus
that's wild.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's do a little editing magic, because we're going to be right back with a little bit more Blinx, but Blinx the second. Yes, we are here again. We're still here. This time, Blinx 2. They actually made a sequel, if you can believe it. As you can kind of gather from this...
Oh, it looks like multiplayer is a focus.
It got weird. It got weird.
I mean, what was that? A multiplayer mode with the oh, yeah, there's a Versus right there. Because yeah. I saw like a four-way split screen. Kind of made me think of Conquer Live and Reloaded.
Let me check something here. Oh, that's cool. Camera settings, left,
oh,
right.
Oh, okay.
The question is,
what is what normal actually, and what is inverted?
Yeah, that's the, I guess
the definition of that changed over the years.
Whoops, that's a cool menu. Man, that has some serious Sega energy going on right there.
Yeah.
Doesn't it?
Absolutely, 100%. So have you played through this one like you've played through Blinx 1?
I have never actually finished Blinx 2. Blinx 1 I've played through many years ago, but Blinx 2, I've played some of it, but I never actually sat down to play through it. Maybe I should.
Before we get into it, can you recall any specific differences from the first to the second game?
Oh man, it's been so long. I can't really remember what... I just remember it being a little bit weird. There's something about it. I think because it has like create a Blinx.
Oh yeah. I mean, I wonder if that's like just for the multiplayer or...
Oh,
because
yeah,
on the back of the box here, it does have like a tiger looking character. Oh yeah, some of those look like someone would be from like Bucky O'Hare.
This one looks cool enough.
These green cats and stuff.
I forgot about this.
Yeah, it says, show your style and customize your character's face, body, and clothes. Team up in two-player co-op mode or duke it out in the battle mode for even more fur-flying, snout-bashing action. So does this have, like, full campaign co-op? Like, local, I wonder?
I don't think so, but... maybe
it does say two-player co-op. I mean it could be like a separate mode.
Wow.
I don't know
if that's true. I've never tried it. That's pretty cool though. Okay, so oh yeah, look at this. Maybe it's okay, we got a team. So
oh, a locker room. Okay, so where is Blinx? Like what if you want to play as Blinx? Like
he's beyond time and space.
Did they ride in us here? I wanted to be playing as Blinx, dang it.
There we go. Oh yeah. So there is the splits. I never tried that. That's cool.
You are working. I love how they're like saying up like you are a time sweeper. It's like, you know, the first words of a choose your own adventure.
Oh no, it's one of these.
Oh, is this going to be like a Ratchet Deadlocked kind of game or something?
No, it's just they have this tutorial thing.
Oh,
here.
Like a force tutorial.
Okay, so I have to locate the balloons.
Okay.
Actually, the controls are not inverted. They are non-inverted.
Like modern style is what you're saying.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, we have to do the little like make sure you're looking in the right direction type of deal.
Yeah, you know what? I would probably describe this game as this is what happens after the game gets more Xbox influence, if you know what I mean. Like this just became more Xbox. Like it's a weird thing to say, but it has a different vibe. It's like this is after they found the identity of Xbox and then they were asked to make the game more Xbox.
Right. Well, let's see. Is there a copyright? Okay. This on the box, it says copyright 2004. So
yeah,
so this is 2 years later, which is a standard dev cycle back then.
Yep. I kind of missed that.
But yeah. The like look up this. And around and stuff like that's very like Halo, right? Like to make sure that your inversion is to your liking.
Oh no, I have that problem where once you've been playing a game with inverted controls,
you can't go back.
Did you try to go back?
Something like putting like an N64 controller in my hands or a GameCube controller in my hands, like usually puts my mind into like inversion mode.
Yep. You're absolutely right.
But then
right.
It's tougher with like a PlayStation or Xbox controller because like those feel so comparatively similar to their modern counterparts.
By the way, I'm liking what they're doing here. Can you see the floor there?
Oh, I mean, it's
duplicated geometry, but they're doing like this warping effect on the surface to give it sort of this like, that's pretty cool.
Like a dark polished surface. It does look pretty.
Yeah. Cool. Oh, they speed up this. That's right. And oh, look, now they have this. You can.
Oh, do you have like Z targeting now?
Yeah, there's Z targeting.
Or how are you switching between those targets?
Tapping the right stick.
So that's like that's Demon Souls style.
Yeah.
Really? Because I'd never seen like right stick based target changing until Demon Souls.
That's how it works.
Interesting.
Well, now you've seen it. You've seen it before. Now
I've seen it on Blinx Xbox 2. Original Xbox.
Masters of Time and Space.
There you go. This is the original Demon Souls, everyone.
Ah, to break the crate.
Blinx 2 Masters of Time and Space is the Demon Souls of Xbox, or the Dark Souls of Xbox.
Man, I wish we could play this in two-player mode.
I know. I had no idea. I wonder if it offers local though.
That's what it is. It is local, I believe. Split screen. Okay, so go find them. Find and defeat the monster with the bomb. So they really tried to stream. Oh, look. Oh, no. I thought that was. Oh, I guess there is sort of a shader effect applied there. Some specular highlights.
Oh, yeah. I mean, at least judging by the floor, it looks like the texture quality is somewhat higher than the first game.
Yeah, it seems that way. So I see the monster over here on the radar.
Oh, you haven't spawned in. Weird. You missed, though.
Yeah, I did. Dang.
You're going to blow up the tutorial.
Yeah, you know, that happens.
Can you not just like exit one of these doors if you don't want to do the tutorial?
No.
Oh, I guess not. Find and defeat the monster with the bomb.
Oh yeah, there he is.
Oh, they've got like a. I mean, that's a
missed it again.
Relatively modern style of showing like what direction the enemy is coming at you from with like the circle thing. I've been playing Returnal, and it has a similar thing.
Yeah,
I think you have to get your adrenaline to a certain level.
It's interesting how much. So this sequel seems to spend a lot more time trying to explain how everything works compared to the first game.
I wonder if there was a lot of people who, if that like dragged down reviews or public opinion, like, oh, I don't understand how I'll play this game. Or they say, oh, the game works like this and I don't like that, but it actually didn't because they just didn't know the controls or something.
Yeah.
But I mean, this was the front end of games becoming perhaps overly tutorialized.
Yeah, this is the beginning of it. Early Xbox was less so.
Yeah, but then they became very afraid of you not understanding how to play, so.
Yeah. Okay.
Now use the retry.
Oh,
well, that's a much better looking explosion than the first game, for sure.
Oh, and then you actually, yep. Here we go. Okay, they improved that mechanic a bit.
Now, I see you've got like...
There we go.
Three, I see you've got three life bar things. Like, is that the same as your hearts that you collected in the first game, I guess? Maybe?
It seems like there's actually a life bar now, plus the hearts. That's what I was just doing here.
Oh, I don't.
So
okay.
It seems like that it's now a two-tiered system where you actually can take some hits.
I noticed that the monsters like kind of have like a more spiky, kind of cool look to them, I guess, versus those like extremely cartoonish looking slimes that were, they looked like something out of like Chex Quest in the first game.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. So, pause the pendulum.
Oh yeah, look at that.
And then we'll go press that switch.
Clear the exam. Hopefully that means the entire exam. That's a bummer.
Right. Gotta fix it. So, which means, oh geez, that guy. I have to collect some rewinds. Here we go.
Now, unfortunately, this one is not on backwards compatibility, and I don't know why. I wonder if it could have something to do with the online modes, perhaps.
I gather that it was just not as popular, well-regarded. If you can call it popular at all.
Yeah.
Blinx, I'm not,
but
I mean, I like it.
I mean, a big part of what I love about the Xbox backwards compatibility program is that there's like so many great games, but also like so many like who even cares about this game type of things on there. Like it feels very welcoming to games of all levels of quality, which I definitely respect. So I don't, you know, if it had been easy to get this game working. Oh, okay. Yeah. We're in the early 2000s now, man.
That's fantastic.
You can't not have bullet time. If you have the option for bullet time in these years and you don't do it, then what are you even doing? Or can you just like run toward it and matrix under it?
Yes. That's pretty good. Man, they were really throwing everything at the wall with this one, huh?
Yeah. And we're only just in the tutorial.
Multiplayer, co-op.
I'm moving on.
Create a character. Wow.
I can't hear it from where I'm sitting, but does this character, is he voiced?
I also cannot hear it currently.
Oh.
Sound is being recorded, though, so we'll find out. Oh, this is interesting.
Oh, wow. We're going places with the Blinx storyline that I... What are humans doing here? This is making me think too much of humans and Sonic.
The girl that he was trying to save was also that way in the first one.
Oh, okay. I guess we've got a little Sonic 06 in here, then.
We do, but before.
Yeah?
Look at... Oh, wow. I like this.
Yeah, that opening kind of looks...
This is an aesthetic. That's for sure.
I mean, it was very similar to the opening of the first game there.
Yeah, yeah.
Time energy is vanishing across the universe. Chuck the mother computer. Oh, is that Blinx?
So Blinx is no longer a character. Blinx is just like an idea.
He's on the box. He's on the box.
Forget your details.
I demand Blinx. I don't want to play as Raiden, Blinx.
I love the fact though that these two games were, this was still from that period where Microsoft was getting more done with Japan.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
They had exclusive games developed for Xbox from Japan. Sega did a bunch. You know, they had Team Ninja cranking out amazing stuff. They had R2 doing these Blinx games. There were some others. There was
From Software with
Otogi.
Yeah, yeah. Oh yes, multiple games, yeah.
And they did the presidential...
Yeah, I'm drawing a blank on the name.
Shooter.
I have the PS4...
Metal Wolf Chaos.
Yes, Metal Wolf Chaos.
Yes, that's what it is.
And then, you know, they didn't really get on original Xbox, but that, like, Japanese relationship continued on to where Xbox was, like, weirdly the place for Japanese RPGs for a few years there.
You're right. Vesperia... Lost Odyssey, Blue Dragon.
Which was also R2, of course.
Infinite Undiscovery.
Yes, I love that name.
They got Enchant Arm from FromSoftware first.
Yes, that's right.
So, yeah, things really... Man, the Xbox One did such a number on the Xbox brand, I think. You know what I mean? Mm. Like, it just... It feels like it was this combination of Don Matrick's obsession with doing Kinect combined with Xbox One. Like, it just changed the way Xbox...
The nature
of Xbox.
Yeah, because Xbox, I mean, in the U.S. at least...
Can't swim.
it's so easy to forget what that time was like, where it was always just lol, PS3, no games, and like everyone was into Xbox 360.
Dude, the Xbox 360 was huge.
And there were so many people that I knew that just because they flubbed the reveal of the Xbox One so badly, which turned out to be a great platform, of course, but they
flubbed... Yeah, Xbox One is good. They flubbed
the messaging before the generation even began so hard that people I knew where all of their friends were on Xbox Live, they were all Xbox 360 people, like, they immediately bought PS4s, even though Microsoft backpedaled. So it's like, I mean, obviously, you know, Microsoft has their audience now, but it was, it's almost like a generation removed from the audience that it was at that time. Like, they've built a new audience that was maybe different from the audience of the Blinx era and the early 360 era, you know?
Yeah, I would agree that the Xbox of today is pretty different from this Xbox.
I think they're trying to somewhat get back to that, though, just like what we were talking about. I mean, it's been tough for them to rebuild their first-party capabilities, and, you know, just like we were saying with Psychonauts, like, I completely forgot there was a time when that was supposed to be an Xbox Game Studios or Microsoft Game Studios joint. And, you know, now that's, like, kind of come full circle back now, which is kind of wild to think about. I don't like the dark blue reflective texture over this water.
Like, no?
I mean, like when you are, I mean, it's the sky, but like, when the sky is reflected and you're pointing the camera at a certain angle, it like almost looks, I don't know. It doesn't look like it's supposed to be there. It looks like an artifact somehow.
Well, I mean, it's an accurate reflection.
I guess it is pretty accurate, huh? I don't know. There's right? Like something a little awkward about it, though.
Probably just in that scene, maybe. Because the original didn't actually have much in the way of real reflections. They were faked reflections. These are legit now.
Yeah, which, I don't know. Sometimes I'm torn on what I prefer in that regard, because, you know, when you have more real reflections, quote unquote, like, you get more artifacts when things aren't visible, you know?
Wrong button.
You know, you didn't get, like, the artifacts at the edge of the water, of the screen, you know, where the water's at the edge of the screen and stuff like that.
Yeah, for sure.
Or, like, can Xbox do the same, like, what do you call it, the picture to texture or whatever that, like, is so common on GameCube?
What's that?
I might be using the wrong term, but there's the way that GameCube does a lot of water reflections.
Oh, no. It's pretty different from
Pretty different on Xbox.
Well, I mean, it depends on implementations, I guess, but Xbox or GameCube has the TEV, which does, that was often used for reflections, and it has a very specific look that causes edges of geometry to sort of warble.
Right. You know, like, what I mean? Like, I always think of like Star Fox Adventures which the water looks really cool in it, but when you're standing in front of it, like, you actually see around Fox's outline, you see himself reflected in the water, which when he's standing in front of it, which makes no sense.
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Like, those kinds of effects were all done pretty differently across systems at this time.
They were. You're absolutely right. Nope.
Yeah, there's definitely a much less cartoonish look to the enemies and
the world. Like, it doesn't have that distorted design.
Yeah. I mean, this almost looks like it could be like a World War II beach level from a shooter game, right?
It does. I think that's part of what lost me with this one. Like, the addition of tutorials everywhere, the more realistic world style that looks way more like typical stuff from that era.
I mean, it looks good.
It looks good. I agree. Yeah, it's a nice looking game.
Maybe less of an identity.
Exactly.
Oh, there you go. Oh, it didn't work.
No, I messed up. I forgot that you have to press it, the buttons at the right time. So let's see here. If I do slow, it wants me to do. Oh, okay. I was looking at the rewind arrow or whatever, and it confused me. Oh boy. Well, you know, I feel like we've just scratched the surface of this game, but maybe have seen enough to sort of understand the difference.
Yeah. Yeah.
As you can see, though, it's a little bit, it's different, right?
Yeah.
As we were just saying, but it's still good. It does play well. The controls, I would say, are better overall. Mm-hmm. They're faster, more streamlined. I just don't like this whole push towards these weird avatars and.
Don't even play as Blinx. I can't believe it.
Exactly. Whoa.
What's going on here?
Oh, I'm actually damaging myself. I exploded the bombs too close.
Yeah, but I'm sure, you know, if you spend time with it and dig into it, I'm sure there's a good game underneath all this. You just have to invest time that perhaps we don't have today.
Oh, it goes all the way back there. Wow. Okay. Let's try exploding this door.
Or do you have to complete some sort of objective to open it, I wonder?
I forget. Oh, well. Nice moves.
Nice moves, Arch.
Catch move. Yeah, all these like little text boxes of them communicating with you.
You gotta have a radio, buddy.
I don't like that. It's still interesting game. The water out here looks pretty good too. You can't swim in it.
Yeah.
But the night, look, not screen space, because this didn't exist yet.
Yep. What happens when you, okay, yeah, I just saw it. Like, when your shadow intersects with the tree, I mean, of course, it just overlaps the shadows, because that's how things were at the time.
There we go.
Oh, that looks just like the cat icon in the first game. A little more does, flashy, yeah. Though. Whoa. Right. Look at the coconuts on those trees. They look like diamonds. They're
very low poly.
Yes.
I love it.
The palm trees themselves don't look bad though.
Actually, that's pretty convincing there. Look at that. The way the shadow projects on not blinks.
Oh, okay. Huh. Yeah, I mean
I thought I was just
they did stuff like that generation. You know what the difference in like kind of color palette makes me think of is
I had to lock onto the door. That's what I did wrong.
Oh, okay. The you know
all right, well,
kind of the more realistic grass and dirt color versus the color palette of the first game kind of makes me think of the difference between like Jumping Flash 1 and 2 and Robert Mondieu. Or that one
Robert Mondieu.
Yeah, that has like kind of like a more like realistic muted color palette.
It does.
Less cartoonish. It kind of makes me think of that. Yeah.
Let's explode these. Oh, he exploded himself.
There you go.
I'll just collect all these. Oh no. Dang it. Ooh, a key.
Maybe that's what you should be doing instead of opening the door. Maybe the key works on that door behind you? I don't know.
Swallow up some bombs. You know, all that stuff.
I think you should just see if that key unlocks the door rather than blowing it up.
No, I needed to blow it up.
Oh, okay.
That's... What I missed, though, was that I can just drop off this ledge right here, and it just takes me right back down there.
Yeah. That's probably, I mean...
So I think I have to target the door like this. That was it.
You know, I guess there's no... I wonder if there's any functionality for, like, explosions. Like, you know how like Beautiful Joe, when you slow down time, like,
oh yeah,
things hit harder and do more damage over time when you're doing slow-mo. Like, it would be cool if in this you could do something similar, like use slow-mo to make the bomb deal more damage to the target over time, you know? But I'm kind of getting the impression that this doesn't do that.
No, I don't think it does that. Okay.
Well, at least we got to another level.
Yeah. Oh.
Eek. But yeah, these are much more kind of cooler Xboxy monster designs compared to the
right. That's what I mean.
The
like
simple the cartoonish stuff in the first game. You know,
this game is just more Xbox, right? It just has more of an Xbox vibe to it,
which is not necessarily a bad thing, but
no, not at all. But it's definitely a game that feels like they were trying to. They knew what the Xbox audience was at this point, and they were trying to capture that. Whereas the first Blinx feels like it was made without understanding what the audience would be.
Yeah.
But when they were still building the audience, basically, right? Because there was no defined audience yet for what Xbox would be. There we go. Oh, yeah. Oops.
Although I really have no concept of whether, like, cartoonish platforming type stuff ever sold well on the original Xbox.
That's a really good question. I mean, with Microsoft canceling things like Torque and Psychonauts, you know, they clearly lost a certain amount of,
Yeah, I mean,
the drinking animation took too long.
I think they wanted some of that, like when they bought Rare, but obviously, like they just didn't have enough time because the Xbox generation was so short. They didn't have enough time to really
put out a
lot of that kind of stuff on Xbox. Although, you know, I'm of the opinion that Grab by the Ghoulies is actually like a fantastic game.
Oh, I like it. Yeah.
I like how they basically remastered it on the
Rare Replay.
Yeah, I love the analog stick-based brawling. Like, I just think it feels really good to play.
Yeah, and it's got a nice look to it.
Yeah, yeah. I like that game a lot.
Maybe we'll have to look at it on here sometime.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly think that might be of the rare games that I've played on Xbox systems. I think Grab by the Ghoulies might actually be my favorite. Although Cameo's pretty good too. Cameo's pretty good. And so is Sea of Thieves.
Sea of Thieves is quite good. I agree. Whew. Took some damage. Man, this feels way more military, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Military. Yeah, this is before Call of Duty was big.
Oh yeah. I mean, wasn't this kind of like on the front end of every game being like either World War II or World War II inspired?
Yeah, that was just. I think Call of Duty was out. Call of Duty 1 was out at this point.
Yeah.
On PC only.
And like I remember playing. I think it was Medal of Honor on PS1.
Yeah. Let's see here.
So, yeah, that's
pause the water.
Oh, there it goes.
But I have to run around enough to. I have to part the water enough to hit these buttons.
Can you not hit them when the water is?
Nope.
Oh, that's weird.
So that's part of the puzzle.
Okay, so that's weird how it defines the cooldown on your time abilities. It says wait 1, wait 2, wait 3.
Oh man. Whew, all right. Well, we've certainly visited the Blinxiverse today.
we've swept some time.
Time has been swept.
We have not yet become masters of time and space, though, but I think we had a solid enough sampling. It has whetted my appetite for digging into these two games myself.
That's all we wanted to achieve. So thanks for joining me on this one, on our first attempt at a different sort. we're going to be mixing it up. You know, Audie will be with me on some of these. You'll be with me on some. Corey on others. It's just, it's going to be a mix. Maybe sometime we'll do all four of us at once.
That'd be crazy.
I think that would be fun.
That'd be very fun.
But for now, that's going to do it for this one. So thanks for joining me.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
And thanks to everybody that made it this far. And if you did make it this far, write in the comments, our tune forever. See you next time.